Okay, hi, good afternoon, everybody. I welcome you all to our weekly Elahé, Omidyar, Mir-Djalali webinar series. In addition to the York University Department of History and Ryerson Department of English, our webinar series is supported by the Department of History, Historical Studies, Near and Middle Eastern Civilizations, Women, Gender, and Sexuality Studies at UTM, Cinema Studies Institute, the Center for Comparative Literature and Critical Studies in Equity and Solidarity at the University of Toronto. We are grateful for the critical support of our sponsoring academic units, specifically York University, which has hosted our webinars today. I am also thankful to colleagues, Professors Leila Purtawaf, Khatir Sheibani, Nima Naqibi, Gulbarg Regabat Alahi, Shahzad Mojab, Victoria Tahmasebi, Sara Saljuqi, Jairan Gahan, Reza Taher Kermani, Arshaviz Muzaffari, and Mahdi Walizadeh for their invaluable support of women poets and Iranian cinema projects. I also like to express our collective gratitude to Canada's Indigenous people and acknowledge this land on which the University of Toronto operates. For thousands of years, it has been the traditional land of Huron Wendat, the Seneca, and most recently, the Mississaugas of Credit River. Today, this meeting place is still the home to many Indigenous people from across Turtle Island, and we are grateful to have the opportunity to work and prosper on their land. We grieve the loss of Indigenous children following the discovery of remains found at the site of a former residential schools in different parts of Canada, such as Kamloops, British Columbia, and Saskatchewan. We mourn the deaths of these children in solidarity with their families and Indigenous communities. The legacy of colonialism and racism in Canada and different parts of the world is painful and ongoing. We recognize the reality that this tragic discovery is further evidence of Canada's genocide of Indigenous peoples. We must acknowledge not just Canada's history of systematic racism against Indigenous people, but the current systematic barriers that excessively impact Indigenous communities. We stand with Indigenous people and Indigenous members of the University of Toronto community, and is committed to dismantle anti-Indigenous racism and any forms of racism in all the world. It is a great pleasure to welcome Dr. Farangis Ghaderi, our speaker today, to the University of Toronto. Welcome, Professor Ghaderi. My colleague and collaborator, Professor Shahzad Mojab, will introduce Professor Ghaderi and moderate today's session. Dr. Mojab is Professor of Leadership, Higher and Adult Education. She has served as the interim principal of New College and the director of Women and Gender Studies Institute at the University of Toronto. She is the past president of the Canadian Association for the Studies of Adult Education. Currently, she is the director of Equity Studies. Please welcome both Professor Mojab and Professor Ghaderi.
Thank you so much, Dr. Talaghani, for your opening statement, which I also share. And thanks also to the indefatigable Professor Tavakkoli for organizing such a rich lecture series over this past and academic year. So hello, everybody, and welcome to this lecture. Bekhir Hatin, Amkatatan Bash, for those who speak Kurdish Sorani, in honor of our guest speaker today, Dr. Farangis Ghaderi. And it is a great pleasure and honor for me that I will introduce a dear friend, a colleague, a scholar, whose work has been a source of inspiration for me and I have always admired her literary aesthetics and her poetic politics and sensibilities. Dr. Farangis Ghaderi is Associate Research Fellow at the Center for Kurdish Studies at the University of Exeter and postdoctoral research at the Institute of Oriental Studies at Jagiellonian University in Krakow, Poland. She has a PhD in Kurdish studies from the Institute of Arab and Islamic Studies of the University of Exeter, and her doctoral research examined the emergence and early development of modern Kurdish poetry. She's the co-editor of Women's Voices from Kurdistan, a selection of Kurdish poetry, which was recently launched, and it was a beautiful event. She's the author of several peer-reviewed articles on non-Kurdish literature. Dr. Ghaderi is also associate editor of Kurdish Studies Journal, co-editor of the Kurdish peer-reviewed social sciences journal called Darwaze, and a member of the editorial board of the Kurdish People, History, and Politics series with Peter Lang, where I am the editor of that series. So it's wonderful to have you here, Dr. Ghaderi, and very much looking forward to your talk, which I'm sure that it would be as beautiful as the poetry of Kurdish women that you're gonna share with us. So the microphone is yours, Farangis Jan.
Thank you so much, Professor Mujab, for this very generous and kind introduction. I'm grateful to you all, to Professor Tavakoli, Professor Talarani, Dr. Arshavas, all the institutions and all the people involved in organizing this wonderful series that I have really personally enjoyed immensely and have learned from a great deal. It is an honor for me to be contributing to the discussion on women poets. So thank you very much for providing this space for me, but also for Kurdish literature. And if I may, I would like also take this opportunity to thank Professor Mujab for her dedication and groundbreaking research on Kurdish women, making Kurdish women a recognizable subject in the field of women's studies, which is the tireless work of decades, that dedication of works of decades. And for all your work, Professor Mujab, over the past year for reinstituting Kurdish Women's Studies Network. Thank you very much. So to contextualize Kurdish women poetry, it is useful to provide a little background on Kurdish poetry first and the condition in which it developed. What I mean by Kurdish poetry is the poetic production in different Kurdish language varieties across geographical territories known as Kurdistan. Shahrzadjan, can we have the PowerPoint, please? Can we have slide 2, please? Thank you. So due to inexistence of national institutions, Kurdish developed on a polydialectical structure. Kurdish with over 30 million speakers constitutes 5 language varieties or dialect groups. Northern Kurdish or Kurmanji, and it is represented in the map. It's at the top section of the map. Represented by horizontal lines. And as you see, it's largely spoken in Turkey and parts of Syria, well, in Syria, but also in Iran and in Iraq. The second main dialect group is Central Kurdish or Sorani, which I've highlighted with red marking in the middle. And as you see, it's spoken in its speakers are mainly in Iran and in Iraq. Southern Kurdish, which is largely located in Iran, but also some areas in Iraq, and this is at the bottom of the map. Gorani or Horami, which is in the map, is represented by a small gray area inside the red marking in Iran. It's spoken, Gorani is spoken in Iran, but also in a small area in Iraq. And finally, Zazaki, which is spoken in Turkey, and it's represented in the map by the dark gray area in top left of the map. Now, Kurdish linguists generally refrain from using words such as dialects, and there are debates whether these are dialects or languages. But for the sake of time today, let's stick to dialect group. So we have five dialect groups: Kurmanji, or Northern Kurdish; Sorani, or Central Kurdish; Southern Kurdish; Gorani, or Horami; and Zazaki. Three of these dialect groups, Kurmanji, Gorani, and Sorani, have strong written literary traditions. If we move to next slide, please. As literary languages, Kurmanji, Gorani, and Sorani developed under the patronage of different Kurdish principalities in the Ottoman and the Persian Empire. And the body of works written in these languages or dialect groups constitute classical Kurdish poetry. The oldest literary tradition is believed to be that of Gorani, which developed from the 15th to the 19th century, largely under the patronage of the Ardalan Emirates, Amarat Ardalan, in the Persian Empire. Gorani was and is also the language of the Ryerson or Ahl-e Haq's religious literature. And this is believed to have contributed to its development as well. Gorani developed into a literary coin in the 17th and 18th century. And it was used as a medium of poetic expressions by non-Gorani speakers, not only in the Ardalan Principality, but also in the neighboring areas. However, following the fall of the Ardalan in the mid-19th century as a result of the centralization policy, which was adopted by the Persian king, Gorani literature and language dramatically declined, and it was never restored. Today, Gorani is spoken in a small area of Horaman or Oramanat in Western Iran and Iraqi Kurdistan. And its use as a written language is limited to a few sporadic attempts. In fact, in 2008, it was recognized as an endangered language by UNESCO. So you see, it's really the decline is quite dramatic from almost a lingua franca of Kurds for centuries to an endangered language, which shows, I think, illustrates how the absence of support, what absence of support could do to a language. Kurmanji literature developed in the Kurdish principalities of the Ottoman Empire, such as Jazira and Botan, from the 16th century and flourished in the 17th century. A progress that continued in the 19th century, but interrupted in the 20th century. Sorani literature, or Sorani as a literary language, was the last to emerge in the late 18th century. And it developed again under the patronage of the Kurdish, semi-autonomous Kurdish principality of Baban, Emirate Baban. Despite its late development, emergence, one could say, Sorani enjoyed an uninterrupted continuity in the 20th century. And from the late 19th century, it replaced Gorani, and its prominence in from the late 19th century also contributed to the decline of Gorani. Is one of the factors that Gorani declined. Now, in the 20th century, so from the classical literature by the late 19th century, we had three main literary traditions in Kurdish: Gorani, Kurmanji, and later Sorani. In the 20th century, the redrawing of national boundaries following the collapse of the Ottoman and Persian empires and the creation of the Middle East left Kurds divided across Turkey, Syria, Iran, Iraq, and Armenia. And as a result, Kurdish language became a stateless language. In Turkey, soon after the establishment of the Turkish Republic, Kurdish language was banned. And this was a restriction that was in place for decades. It was actually only eased in the 1990s, early 90s. Kurdish had the same fate in Syria, except for a short period under the French mandate. As a result, as you can imagine, as a result of this political suppression, the development of Kurmanji was severely interrupted in the 20th century. And it mainly developed in the diaspora. In Iran, Kurdish was tolerated, except for a period under the Reza Shah, but was not encouraged. And the condition of its development was not provided. The dominant Kurdish dialect in Iran is Sorani. And Sorani really developed in Iraq in the 20th century. And Iraq became, because of the new political situation in Iraq, became the only place that Kurdish cultural activities were allowed to an extent. So this is an image, very short introduction to classical literature and the condition of Kurdish, the condition in which Kurdish literature developed and in the 20th century. And in the 20th century, writing and publishing in Kurdish for much of the 20th century in itself, writing and publishing in itself was an act of resistance and was a form of activism and often entailing dangerous or perilous activism. In the study of Kurdish literature, we have two main challenges, which is related to the conditions as I just explained. Firstly, under the repressive conditions, as Professor Hasanpour noted, under the repressive conditions in Turkey, Syria, and Iran, we have lost a significant part of Kurdish literary heritage because manuscripts, especially those in private possessions, were destroyed. And we have many testimonies about this. In fact, Kurdish memoirs and autobiographies are replete with accounts of how, out of fear, Kurdish people were forced to destroy the Kurdish collections. And of course, among these collections were manuscripts. And there were also many accounts of newly published books or journals being destroyed by state forces in all parts of Kurdistan. And second challenge in the study of Kurdish literature is that a considerable size of Kurdish written heritage has remained unpublished in forms of manuscript and in archives across the Middle East and even outside Kurdistan. And they have remained unpublished for political as well as economic reasons. So against this backdrop, the image we have of Kurdish literature and its development is, as you would appreciate, is fragmented, is disjointed, and is partial. And our knowledge of classical literature, and in particular of women literature, women's contribution before the 19th century, is limited. However, the discovery of new manuscripts and resources over the last decade have brought new literary figures to light. In this talk, I present two examples, in fact, three examples, of such rediscoveries, one in classical poetry and two in modern poetry, which illustrate, I hope this example exemplify the precarity of Kurdish literary heritage, but also complex structures of exclusions faced by Kurdish women whose voice have been marginalized, dismissed, and demoted in Kurdish literary history. Before the 19th century, literary texts by women known to us are mainly oral, and they include the religious texts of Ryerson, the kalams of Ahl-e-Haq, Ryerson Pirs, And we have examples by your women peers from the 13th and the 14th century, such as the Kalam of Dairak Khatun of the 13th century, Pir Nazdar or Nergis Khanum Shahrazuri. So many examples. Of written heritage, we know of few literary figures in the 19th century, as I mentioned. But the most distinguished voice, we can say, in the 19th century is that of Mahsharaf Khanum, Mastura Ardalan, or Mastura Kurdistani. Next slide, please, Sharzajan. Mastura was a poet who wrote in Persian and in Kurdish. A few weeks ago, we heard a fantastic lecture by Professor Brooke Shaw, in which he talked about Mastura and her Persian writing. But Mastura was also a historian. And in fact, in the Kurdish context, she's mainly known or best known for Tarikh Ardalan, for writing Tarikh Ardalan, the history of the Ardalan, and another book entitled Shar'iyat. The image on the right-hand side is a image of a manuscript of Tarikh Ardalan, and this is believed to be Mastura's handwriting. This manuscript is currently in the possession of Jin Archive Center in Soleimania in Iraqi Kurdistan. But Mastura's Kurdish poetry was discovered fairly late. Her Diwan was published in 1926 and in 1983. And it was only in 1998, as late as 1998, when was the publication, the third publication of her Diwan. Her Diwan included some of her Kurdish writing, which were in Gorani. In 2011, however, a more complete collection of her Kurdish poems was published by Muhammad Ali Qaradaghi, and this publication was based on a manuscript which was found at Berlin Library, interestingly. And this manuscript, which became the basis of the new and to date most complete version of Mastura's Diwan, contained mainly Persian poetry by Kurdish poets and Persian poets, and also the works of Molevi, prominent Gorani poet of the 19th century, and Mastura, mainly Molevi's poetry, but about 60 pages of Mastura's poetry as well. And what is very interesting about this manuscript was that it included one poem by Sultan Khanum, one Kurdish poem by Sultan Khanum, who was is believed to be Khosrow Khan's sister, Khosrow Khan Ardalan's sister, so Mastura's cousin and sister-in-law. And Sultan Khanum, this, at least I haven't heard of Sultan Khanum in any other document, historical literary document. She wrote under the pen name of Izzet. Mastura's Kurdish poetry illustrates a deep connection to Gorani literary heritage, but also to oral literature. Next slide, please. So in terms of form, the most distinguishable feature different from her Persian writing is the use of syllabic meter, syllabic or hijaic meter in her Gorani writing, and the use of Masnavi rhyme. And both Masnavi rhyme and syllabic meter are established features of classical Gorani poetry, but also features of oral literature, oral poetry. The poems that have survived are mostly laments for her husband, Khosrow Khan Ardalan. I'd like to read a sample of her Kurdish poem in Kurdish, a few lines at least in Kurdish, so that you get a sense of her writing and her tone, because it's sometimes difficult to convey that, well, not sometimes, it's really difficult to convey that tone in translation. Translation is mine. So this poem is a lament for Khosrow Khan. Khasram wahar, khasram wahar, yashaw nayawa imsaw nawahar, bernayan wabar gulan jagulzar, nakaro dirakht shkofa ishar, nasahni chaman nawan bulbul, hani nakesho jala narigul, nilufer ta hashr bernayo jaaw, jarui gulasurkh nakesho gulaw. My Khosrow, spring is here. How I wish it would not have come this year, that no sprouts would have sprung in the garden, no trees would have come into buds, no nightingale in the meadow, no dew on the petals. How I wish water lilies did not bloom till doomsday, and no rose water was steeped, that violets, wallflowers, and hyacinths never push out of the ground again, that tulips, lilies, yellow flowers, and basil would not spring forth my pain. How I wish the throngs of blossoms would be destroyed and poppies would yellow with aching hearts. So the poem is a lament, which is an established poetic form in Gorani literary tradition. But when we compare Mastura's lament to her male counterparts, we notice striking differences in language. Mastura's lament in language, in a sense, we can certainly say Mastura's language is feminine. It has feminine quality. Mastura's laments are, as I said, influenced by the oral genre, oral poetry, but specifically the oral genre of Sheen, that is a lament for the dead, which is a female genre, which is considered as a female genre, which has deeply personal language and tone, as we see in this poem by Mastura. Now, it's worth noting that as Professor Christine Allison has pointed out in an article on women's representation in oral literature in Professor Mojab's seminal book, Women of Non-State Nation, the Kurd, women also use sheen, lament, Kurdish women. They use sheen to describe sadness and anger about things that other than bereavement. So it is obviously for the occasion of bereavement, but it has other functions as well to express sadness and even anger. Now remember that Mastura was forced into a life of exile after Khosrow Khan's death, away from her home, Ardalan's library that she refers to on a number of occasions in her poetry. And without her status, one wonders if the laments are for her own life and her, as she called it, her black fortune. Mastura was praised by male Kurdish poets, most notably by Molevi and Komasi, but was also the target of a very famous satire by Nali, renowned Kurdish poet, male poet of the 19th century and one of the pillars of classical Sorani poetry. Nali's satirical poem could be viewed as an attitude, as the attitude of a dominantly male literati, Kurdish literati toward women writers. But it could also be interpreted in the light of the rivalry between two Kurdish principalities, of Ardalan and Baban. But whatever the interpretation, however we interpret this poem, what I find puzzling is that while Nali's satire is well canonized, Mastura's poems are not. In Maruf Khaznadar's impressive 7 volumes Kurdish literary history, the most comprehensive account of Kurdish literature to date, Mastura doesn't have an entry. But interestingly, 8 pages are dedicated to Nali's satire, to this satire in the satire of Mastura. And the poem is praised for its literary quality. The scarcity of women's voices in classical poetry has been explained by socioeconomic reason, as well as, of course, the loss of manuscript. However, a male-dominated image of Kurdish literature continues with modern poetry and in 20th century. In fact, judging by Kurdish literary history, Kurdish literary historiography written by men, of course, women's poetry was a late phenomenon. And emerging only in the last decades of the 20th century. And this is, interestingly, is an image that has been repeated both in scholarly studies of Kurdish literature, but also in translation. And for instance, English translations of Kurdish literature that I have studied and written an article published recently, exactly repeat this same image that women, there are not many women in Kurdish literature, in Kurdish poetry. Anthologists, translators, literary critics often cite that they struggle, literally the word struggle, they struggle to find women poets. So presenting as if, you know, there isn't any, creating this image. However, examining the Kurdish periodicals and literary journals that emerged from the early decades of the 20th century reveals an active female contribution to the development of Kurdish literature. Women poets, often writing under pseudonym, have been disregarded by literary historians and critics. A striking example is, can we have slide 6, please? Next. Thank you. So a very fascinating example is the discovery of a divan by Zeynep Khan. In the process of the republication of the pioneering Kurdish literary journal Gelavesh. Now, Gelavesh was published from 1939 to 1949, and it was significant because it was led by the very prominent literary figures. It was the editor-in-chief and the editorial board were among the Kurdish canon, but it was also the first dedicated literary journal, Kurdish literary journal. Now, the original copies of the journal are held by Jean, and they republished the entire collection, the entire journal in 16 volumes. And the editors decided to dedicate the first volume to information, to providing information about the authors featured in the journal. And they came across a piece, a prose poetry that you see on the left side. Which was signed by Küçe Kurt, Kurdish girl. Such references are usually dismissed by male critics, but one researcher, Abdullah Zangana, tirelessly strove to discover the true author of the piece, and he soon discovered the author was indeed Zeynep Khan Mela Rauf Khadem Sojada. Can we have next slide, please? The author was indeed Zeynep Khan, and Zeynep Khan was the eldest sister of Dildar, the revolutionary poet and the author of the Kurdish anthem. And in the image that we have, that's unfortunately the only image survived of Zeynep Khan featuring her was her husband, and at the back, the young man is Dildar. They lost the parent when Dildar was very young, and Zeynep Khan wrote of Dildar. And it's very interesting that Dildar has talked about her sister, the influence of her sister in her in his career, but obviously it hasn't been taken with much hasn't been noticed. Now, when Zangana reached out to Zainab Khan's family, to his astonishment, he discovered a substantial unpublished manuscript, handwritten by Zainab Khan herself. And on the right side, you have an image of this manuscript that Zangana discovered and had remained with the family for 55 years. Zangana published a divan at his own expense because he didn't want the book to be published with any emblem of any political parties or institutions. So he published it at his own expense and in 2018. So this divan, this collection was published 55 years of Zainab Khan's death. The divan includes 190 poems and 27 quatrains in Sorani dialect. And it is really interesting that all the poems are dated. And this is very uncommon in Kurdish manuscript to find, for some reason, Kurdish poets didn't think much of dating their work. But we see that Zainab Khan very carefully has dated all her work. And sometimes the poems are accompanied by notes, as in this image on the right, explaining the context of their composition. So quite remarkable in its very physical feature. But her diwan is truly fascinating for its content as well. Her poetry covers a wide range of topics, but most notably Kurdish nationalism and women's rights. And she also presents a very strong anti-colonial, anti-British stance. In one of her poems, she says, she curses Britain and says, may God do to you what you did to Kurds. If we look at some samples of her poem, can we have next slide, please? You see how remarkable her work are. In this poem that was written in 1929, entitled "Sha'irani Kurd," Kurdish poets. Zainab Khan writes about her frustration with Kurdish poets, but with Kurdish male poets, who, as she describes, are busy with the hair and the mole of the beloved and have neglected the nation. Let's read, I'll read the first two lines of the Kurdish just to give you a sense of the difference between Sorani and what we read earlier in Gorani, and also to have a sense of her tone and language. شاعرانی کرد همیشه باسی زلفی خودکن هر باسی تیری مشگان و نگای مستی چودکن یکی به آخ و آف و یکی به شیون و زاری هموی اسیری دلبرن باسی تور و دودکن Kurdish poets only write about the soft hair of the beloved, her intoxicated eyes, her spare-headed eyelashes, busy with thighs and moaning, wailing and howling, trapped in the snares of the beloved. The hearts torn sunder, one set sliced. Ah, it is such a state. What should be the state of the nation with such poets, blabbering lust, all blowing their own horns? They think of themselves, the wise Aristotle of the age, but only teach lovemaking and fail gambling. Come, ponder the sorrowful state of the Kurdish nation. But offended by Zainab's words, they turn their faces away. I really love this final image of Kurdish male poets turning their faces away like children. And I think she has managed to describe that perfectly. In her poetry, Zainab Khan invites women to take active role in the resistance movement and take up arms. But she recognizes and acknowledges their limitation. And the women, she describes, quote unquote, enslaved. And so they must strive to educate themselves. In the 20th century, the so-called women's question, precision, occupied the Kurdish intellectuals' minds, and it was really one of the main themes of modern Kurdish poetry. The question, of course, was related to the theme of progress, modernity, and nationhood. Women's education and liberation was part of the Kurdish nationalistic discourse that argued that Kurdish society would not progress until it has liberated and educated women, because educated women, well-educated women, give birth to the to educated and learned men. Kurdish women were also encouraged to unveil, as veiling was associated with backwardness, but also veiling was considered the legacy of the colonizer and un-Kurdish. It was often argued by Kurdish intellectuals that Kurds did not have veiling, and this is the legacy of the Arab and Persian culture. As Hemen, prominent Kurdish poet from Mahabad, famously wrote in a poem addressing Kurdish girls, and this poem is very famous in Kurdistan. I quote, "Your grandmother did not see veiling. These rags are the enemy's gifts to us." So veiling is a is enemy's legacy, and so Kurds had to get rid of. But the discussions, such discussions, were largely male-dominated, male-led. But Zeynep Khan's poetry, which, as I mentioned, we have only discovered in 2018, provides an opportunity to study the emergence of so-called new Kurdish women from a woman's perspective. Zeynep Khan asks, can we have next slide, Sharzajan? Thank you. Zeynep Khan asks women to be strong. In fact, the word kudret is she uses a lot to ask women to be strong, to be powerful, strong both physically but also mentally, and ask women to have their own thoughts and pursue education, as it's illustrated in this poem entitled "Women's Voice," and this is, as you see, was written in 1936. A woman must have strength. She must know how to enter the arena. And excuse my literal translations, they do not do justice to the Kurdish poem at all. Women must have strength. They must know how to enter the arena. No use of empty words, the lioness of the life. This is a reference to a Kurdish proverb. She must have ideas, be brave, forward thinking and thorough. She must not be just busy with yarn and cradle in the corner of the house. What would be woman's weight? What would a woman's weight be if she is called a za'ifa? And this is a word shared by Kurds as well. Wasn't Fatima a woman, the martyr of two, the mother of two martyrs? Now, it's really interesting. That's from this reference, from this religious icon, reference to a religious icon as an image of a strong woman. She then moves further in the poem to Engels and Marx's mother. She says, Engels and Marx, who wrote ideology in collaboration, had noble mothers, possessors of kind hearts. I don't have time to bring, I mean, her poetry are truly remarkable, but we can't discuss further her work. But Zeynep Khan, who wrote under the pen name of Kitcha Kurt, is not the only example of a significant female poet and a sister of a well-known male poet. As I mentioned, she's a sister of Dildar, very well-known in Kurdish literature. She's not the only example to have remained unknown, despite having quality work in her own right. But in my research, actually, I've found that, that this is quite a common phenomena. Can we have next slide, please? Another very interesting example is Ferishte Koyi. Her full name, her real name was Khadija Mustafa Hevezi. Khadija had two brothers, Ahmed Dalzar and Karim Shahrezad, and both of them are well established in the Kurdish canon. So her two brothers, Ahmed Dalzar and Karim Shahrezad, are well canonized, yet Farishta is fairly unknown outside her hometown of Konya. Coming from a poor background, she was denied schooling at a young age, but she gained basic literary education, as we are told, by her family later in her life. According to her nephews and nieces, she never married. According to her family, she gained basic education, but she had difficulty writing. So she would recite her poem and would ask a family member to write them down. And she knew thousands of classical and modern lines, including her own brothers, by heart. Apparently, she knew all of her brothers' work by heart. And her own work, her own poetry, covers a wide range of topics, but predominantly her communist ideology and women's rights. Next slide, please. So she was an active member of the Iraq Communist Party, Hezb-e-Shiyui, for decades, and she joined the armed struggle, took part in the armed struggle as well. She was one of the two Kurdish women in the Iraqi women's delegation visiting China and Russia in 1959. And she writes about her account of this visit in a poem, Çim Değile Çin, What Did I Saw in China? Which is fascinating. She was in particular very impressed by women's presence in the workforce. I must say I'm very grateful to Mr. Barzan Kerim Shahrezad, Farishta's nephew, for sharing these photos with me and allowing me to share them here with you. A small collection of her poems was published only in 2005. But not as a book, shockingly, not as a book, but as a pamphlet in about 1,000 copies, which was distributed among family and friends. So her work was published as a pamphlet, but really didn't travel much outside of her own family circle. Now, I would finish with the final example. Next slide, Shahrezadjan, please. That one would assume, at least I would assume, that female poets, I had assumed that female poets who had published their works would face a different fate. But finding Samia Shakir, who wrote under the pen name of Mashkal, torch or light, challenged this assumption. Samia wrote from the late 1950s, and she published two poetry collections in 1973 and 1984. And some of her poems turned into songs, and they were broadcasted from radio, Kurdish radio, in the 60s. And she later moved to Germany, gained a PhD in sociology, wrote her PhD on women's Kurdish women in Iraqi Kurdistan. And one would assume that such a person would not remain anonymous, but she has. She has recently published her memoir, which I haven't yet managed to find. And again, it seems as it has a very, very limited distribution. So I had to contact her personally and to waiting for the biography to be posted to me. I will conclude that I had to earlier when I read out, I had some other example, but I had to delete for the shortage of time. But there are many examples of such poets that I have discovered in my research. From the early 90s, however, Kurdish female voices could no longer be dismissed, and it began to be heard in public and literary spheres in Kurdistan. In the 1990s, the formation of the autonomous Kurdish region and a Kurdish government in Iraq, as well as lifting the ban on the publication in Kurdish in Turkey, played a crucial role in the revitalization of Kurdish literature and the emergence of female voices in public life. In the second half of the 2000s, the Kurdish publishing house, Avesta, which is based in Istanbul, launched a series called Shamaran, which is dedicated to Kurdish female poetry. And they have so far published an impressive 32 volumes of work of mainly contemporary poets from all parts of Kurdistan. And such a collection highlighted for the first time the presence of women in Kurdish literature. Exclusion of women's voices, as it has been discussed in this series, is prevalent in historiography and literary canonization, and Kurdish literature is, of course, no exception. For Kurdish women writers, however, the political position of Kurdistan, statelessness, political and cultural suppression, the hegemony of the state languages, Arabic, Persian, and Turkish, the complex nature of the Kurdish politics itself, the Kurdish party politics, the interdialectal power relations, and the marginalization of smaller dialect groups such as Gorani, Zazaki, and Bahdinani, as well as patriarchy, have compounded their dominated status. Thank you so much for your patience, and I look forward to your comments, feedback, and questions.